Wow, good stuff. Praise the Lord, huh? What about that line? That last song was awesome. They're all awesome, but take me where there's faith without borders or boundaries or something. Faith without borders. That's awesome. I love that. And it just really goes right along with the life of Job and the story of Job. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and take them out. Turn to the book of Job, chapter 3. So we're tracking the life of Job, the guy that you don't hear too many people saying they want to be like. You hear a lot about Paul, Peter, and you don't hear too many people saying, "Lord, make me like Job," but we should. We should. What a blessing, though, that we have the earliest written book in the Bible, the book of Job, that shows us that the human condition from all of history has much to do with suffering and misery. So this isn't one of those feel-good messages, but there is hope, and that's really the important thing. How well do we suffer is a good question. Are we prepared to suffer? Are we grounded in the Lord for when those storms come, those times come? And for those of us, I'm sure most of us, we know what misery feels like. And we've probably found a lot of surprising things in misery that we would have never found without misery. And I think about things that pain has taught me that I could have never learned on my own. And I see that with Job. Chapter one, it just gives us this impression of this guy that was just so awesome. He was blameless, he was upright, he feared the Lord. And it was God who selected him as Satan presented himself to God. And God said, "Hey, have you considered my servant Job?" And I just think about that. It really just has stuck in my mind, the fact that Job was the one selected for this. And it really causes us to think about the things that God values. Because he saw something in Job, in his character, that was something that God acknowledged that he wanted to bring Job to a whole nother level. And if you think about it, as well as Job was doing, it was the taking away of all that he had that brought him to such a greater level of what God values and of what's really important, and that's our faith in God and our relationship with God. Ultimately, the book ends up giving us this one thing that we can hold on to when we go through trials, the thing that really will get us through, and the thing that's going to be attacked the most, and it's just simply faith. Faith will get us through any and every trial. It is faith. It is faith that's being attacked when we're in a trial. The shield of faith, once we drop that, if Satan is successful in getting us to drop the shield of faith, we become very vulnerable to all the other attacks. We don't have anything left if we don't have faith. So he goes after that. So preparing to suffer is knowing that it is faith that will get us through anything and everything. And Job is an example of that. Job was chosen for this trial. He was afflicted by Satan. God put limitations on the afflictions. And Satan's challenge basically came down to that God inherently wasn't worthy in and of himself to be worshiped and praised. that it was the bestowal of things which caused people to praise God and worship God. And so that was the challenge. The first challenge in chapter 1 was wiping out his things, more things that were outside of him, his possessions, his family. His whole family was wiped out. His possessions were wiped out. And Job still didn't curse the Lord. Job would say, "Naked I came, naked I go, blessed be the Lord," and he worshiped the Lord, signifying that through the complete loss of every possession that he had, everything that was valuable to him in a worldly sense, that he still valued his relationship with God. And so the second challenge was Satan saying, well, if you touch his flesh, if you afflict his body, that's taking it to a whole nother level. You can take away his stuff, that's outside of him, but now you afflict something that's personal to him, his body, and then he'll curse you to your face. And God allowed him to do that, inflicting him with boils from head to toe, excruciating, painful boils. And Job still held on to his faith. And what's interesting, what we're going to look at tonight, I want to sort of look at this idea that God said, you can afflict him, you can touch his body, you can take all his stuff, but you can't touch his life. Why is that interesting? Because in this chapter 3, he wants to die. He wishes Satan could have had his life. Have you ever felt like that? You're just so miserable, you just want to die. I don't know if I think that. I usually think, Lord, this would be a great time for the rapture right now. This would be awesome. But everything that can be thrown at a person that would make a person miserable, suffer, hurt, it all just came in like a whirlwind to him. And notice at the end of chapter 2 then, his three friends came to minister, so to speak, quote unquote, to him as they heard about his adversity. And it names who they are. And it says in verse 12, they raised their eyes from afar. They did not recognize him. They lifted up their voices and they wept. And each one tore his robe, sprinkled dust on his head toward heaven. And they sat down with him on the ground for 7 days and 7 nights. And no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his grief was very great. So that's the picture of somebody, what I would imagine or picture at that moment, experiencing the greatest amount of grief a human being could experience. And I don't know, it may be possible to experience more grief than he did, but I don't think so. And in his grief, we all can pick segments of his grief that we can identify with. But I haven't met anybody, there probably is, but I haven't met anybody that has all of those things happen at one time in the way that it did with Job. So chapter 3 then, after 7 days, those guys are just sitting with him. I love that picture, because that's a really great picture of how to minister to people. Just letting them go through the process and just being there with him. But it then gave Job an opportunity to now express the things that he was feeling. And so chapter 3 begins the poetical part of the book of Job. Before that, it was a historical narrative type. So that's why this is categorized into poetical books. So it says, Job opened his mouth. His first response was he cursed the day of his birth. So interesting. He was sitting there so miserable. His buddies are around. And he didn't curse God. Remember, that was the challenge, wasn't it? That was the challenge. That you look at chapter 2, verse 5. It says, but stretch out your hand now and touch his bone of his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face. That was the challenge. So that's what Satan's trying to get him to do. That's also what he's trying to get us to do. But look in verse 6. He says, "And the Lord said to Satan, Behold, he is in your hand, but spare his life." And now, see, this is so crazy because Job doesn't want his life anymore. And this shows you the value of a life. That when we think our lives are completely a waste, completely unuseful. Have you ever felt like that? Like your life is just not useful at all. There's no reason for you to be here. You're just taking up space on the planet Earth. You're sucking oxygen out of the Earth. And there's no purpose. That's how he was feeling. It's hard to feel like there's a reason. When you're suffering and you're afflicted, especially from a guy who is so proactive in helping his family, sacrificing, praying for his family, probably helping them financially, and where we find out that he is ministering to all these people, encouraging people, and he's gotten to a place where he thinks, because of his inability to do all the things that he was doing before, his life is completely useless. So he says, "The day I was born, that was a cursed day." So remember, he's now emoting, if you will. He's expressing his emotion. We get this such an inside track of the feelings of a man going through such misery. And so he says in verse 2, it says, "Job spoke and he said, May the day perish on which I was born, and the night in which it was said, a male child is conceived." So now he's thinking. He's trying to figure out the struggle. This is what happened. See, there's no more affliction in the book of Job. The affliction's over. Affliction lasted for two chapters. But that initiates the real battle. The affliction starts that battle of the spiritual warfare. It starts the battle of us struggling for understanding, grasping for control, looking for coping mechanisms, things that just will soothe our pain or bring some kind of understanding or make us feel better in any way or shape or form. We become very vulnerable at those moments. That's what we need to be very careful about. But look at what's happening here. This is so amazing. He doesn't want to live. What he doesn't really understand, though, quite yet, is that God is working a process for him to live more. You know how the Bible says, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it will only produce one stalk. But if it falls to the ground and dies, it'll bring forth much fruit. Jesus was saying that as he was pointing to his glorification on the cross. He was pointing to his death on the cross that would glorify him. Isn't that interesting? You know, the Bible says that we have all sinned and what? Fallen short of what? The glory of God. So sin rips off the glory of God. It takes away the potential of our life. And so as believers, we have this unlimited potential of growth and development in God's glory. And that's why Paul said, "I haven't apprehended it yet, but I press on to the upward calling," basically saying that there's so much more for me to get, that my outward man is perishing, but my inner man is going from glory to glory. It's about the glory of God. That's the attainment of the potential of a human being. Sin rips that off. Jesus restores that through his death and resurrection. And those who place their faith in Christ, he restores the glory of God to that individual. And then we continue to grow in that glory. But you'll notice in our story, the growth and development of the glory of God in our life, it comes, what Job didn't know, it comes through the death to our self life in this world. That's what Jesus said in that John 12 verse where he talked about dying. And he said, unless we lose our life, we can't gain our life. And he says, unless we hate our life in this world. He's speaking about now this death process that happens in the believer's life. We call that sanctification. But it's the painful process of us dying to the world and to ourselves. It's the crucifixion of our flesh. And so there are times where we feel like dying. It's because we are still holding on to the wrong life. And that's the key here, is as we grasp on to eternal life that's growing in the times where our material physical life is dying, then we will begin to understand that this misery is killing the bad in order to grow the good. And that's the amazing thing about this story. And this whole chapter is about him wanting just to die. But you'll see a progression here. And before I move on, I want you to notice one little thing, just a little side note. When he talks about in verse 3, he says, the second part, he says, and the night in which it was said, the male child is conceived. So when is a human being a human being? When they're born? He says it's a male child at the point of conception. You might want to highlight that or put that in your back pocket somewhere. Cool verse, but watch this. Poetically then, he says in verse 4, he says, may that day be darkness. May God above not seek it. So what's happening now is because he's so confused. Now he's questioning God's purpose and plan. And that's a temptation that we face when we begin to suffer, when things go sideways, especially when it's unexpected. We get blindsided. We start to wonder, did you make a mistake, God? Or did you concentrate on the Middle East and you forgot this thing happened in my life? You start to wonder, how could this be God's plan? Can you imagine Job thinking Lord, you want to put me through this, but how is that good that all my kids die? Where's the goodness there? How is that good? And remember, Job didn't have the book of Job to read. So he's just going through this, and he's trying to, you see him trying to make sense of it, but his emotions, I want you to notice another thing. We're not called to be stoic, meaning unemotional. We're human beings. God made us to have emotions. It's not bad to feel that. It's not bad and a sin to hurt. It's not bad to go through and express these feelings and these emotions. Actually, it's good and it's healthy. What's a sin is to deny God and to reject faith and to call what's happening something that we would curse God or point to God as someone who's unjust or something like that. But we go through these emotions. I want to encourage you that that's normal and healthy to feel sad. Did Jesus feel sad ever? I mean, Jesus felt sad. That's normal, but to take those emotions and do the right things with them. Take them to the Lord. Express our heart to the Lord. Cry out to the Lord. The Psalms are just so intense with these feelings that people took so wonderfully to the Lord. So now in verse 5, he says, May darkness and the shadow of death claim it. May the clouds settle on it. May the blackness of the day terrify it. As for that night, so he's going all the way back to his conception. And he's like, Lord, couldn't you just have stopped that night? Couldn't you just have changed things, Lord? Look how it's all ended up. This conception has led to such misery. And I don't understand, Lord, why? I don't see a purpose. I don't see my life as even being a life that should occupy a place on this earth. There's no reason to it. So be very careful when we think in some way, shape, or form that our life is not valuable. Because God puts so much value on an individual life. He tells us to look at the birds of the air, look at the sparrows, look at the lilies of the field. He counts the number of hairs on our head. He's specifying that he is 100% completely, fully, all of God is interested in the individual. Everything, his whole being is interested in our whole being, signifying the value that he places on the individual. And that each individual is so unique. There's just not one in the whole world that's out of 6 billion people currently living on the face of the earth. There's not one of you. That's wild, isn't it? You think about it, there's not one of you. That's how amazing and valuable. And then there's not one individual like you, and there's not one individual that has the purpose that God has placed in your life. That then now he gives each individual this amazing potential to be amazing in the eyes of God. But see, Job couldn't see that because he was struggling with his value system. And looking at his value based on the things that he saw were important and not understanding that there are so many other things that he had no idea. We are recipients of his value right now, aren't we? Aren't you glad Job went through this? We could read about this. There's so much we've gleaned. Job didn't know we'd be reading this. Setting this incredible theology and understanding to spiritual warfare and suffering and God and all these amazing truths that are set forth. But that's how God works, doesn't he? So in verse 6, it says, as for that night, you just can't get over that night when he was conceived. And he's almost like praying. He's like, Lord, just make darkness seize it. He's like, trying to change it. Like, can we like go in a time machine, Lord, and go back to that night and just mess up that night so it didn't happen? And so that's a struggle that we do, that we have, is we put a lot of energy and effort trying to change something that we just can't change. And the answer is to embrace our situation knowing God works all things together for good. Verse 6, again, as for that night, may darkness seize it. May it not rejoice among the days of the year. It's basically saying, don't let my birthday even be celebrated because it's terrible. Verse 7, may that night be barren. May no joyful shout come into it. May those who curse it, who curse the day, speaking of special sorcerers that they would have in the day that would pronounce curses on things and people. He's saying just let them curse it. Those who are ready to arouse the Leviathan, which we'll talk a lot about that in chapter 41. But basically, suffice it to say, probably from the text, it was a mythical sea monster, kind of like the Loch Ness Monster, that would exemplify chaos and evil. And basically, he's saying just let these mythical creatures curse this day. May the stars of its morning be dark. May it look for light, but have none, and not see the dawning of the day, because it did not shut up the doors of my mother's womb, nor hide sorrow from my eyes. Now he transitions. He realizes he couldn't change the night of his conception. So now he says, why did I not die at birth? Couldn't change that, but Lord, why couldn't I just have died right there? And you know, there's something interesting about that, because that's probably one of the hardest things an individual can go through, is a loss of a newborn or an infant, a baby. Just think about that, just how terrifying, horrible, terrible thing that is. And he's suffering so much misery. He's saying, if I was going to be conceived and I couldn't change that, Lord, why couldn't I have just died right in the beginning? Again, failing to realize, because of his misery, that his life meant something. That his life was important, that his existence on the earth was going to count for something. And that's what he's having trouble tracking with. He says in verse 11, why did I not perish when I came from the womb? Why did the knees receive me? Or why the breasts that I should nurse? For now I would have lain still and been quiet. And I would have been asleep. And then I would have been at rest. And so now he takes it a whole nother direction. And he's sort of getting off of the truth. He's starting to think that if he would have died, and incorporating this idea of soul sleep, where when people die, they're just like asleep. And he's rebuked in chapter 38 for speaking words without knowledge. But his emotions are taking him to a place where he's looking for any comfort and relief. And it's interesting, because when we go through times of crisis and suffering and misery, our understanding of God and our knowledge of his word often gets challenged. And so we have to be very careful in those times, that we don't change what we know the Bible to say is true because we want to feel better about our situation. And so we could go down this road, and we'll be tempted to go down this road, where Satan will try to bring us into lies and misunderstandings about God. And so he stands right there just waiting to whisper things in our ear to lead us down that wrong direction or that wrong road. Our emotions and our feelings are quite a powerful force. And that's why God's given us His Word, that we can always stand upon the truth that will never pass away. And I've talked to so many people that have told me about things that they believe that are not biblical, and I ask them why they believe that, and it never has anything to do with the Bible. It always has something to do with some experience they've had. They don't think there's hell anymore because they just can't see. They've had friends that died and can't see how God would send somebody to hell. And they just come up with these emotional type of ideas that are unbiblical. And so Job starts now going into a direction like that, which is really weird. Look at verse 14. He says, with the kings and counselors of the earth who built ruins for themselves, or with princes who had gold, who filled their houses with silver, or why was I not hidden like a stillborn child, like infants who never saw light? There the wicked cease from troubling, and there the weary are at rest. There the prisoners rest together. They do not hear the voice of the oppressor. The small and the great are there, and the servant is free from his master. And so now he's just picturing, I had to be conceived, I guess. So why couldn't I have just died right at birth and then joined all these other people who died and just went into this place where there's no more misery or hurting or suffering? And his understanding of salvation and heaven and all those things, whether he had a good grasp of that before this or not, we really don't know. But again, in chapter 38, God rebukes him for speaking words without wisdom, for saying things that were coming from darkness and not light. And see, so Job comes from a place where he says, naked I came, naked I go, blessed be the Lord. And now he's got all this heavy affliction on him. And he's just longing, what he's doing is longing for any kind of relief. And here is an area we have to be so careful. When we become desperate people, which as Christians, we should never be desperate for anything other than the Lord Himself. When we become desperate, Vince Lombardi said, fatigue makes cowards out of us all. That's really true. When we go through such heavy affliction and suffering, there's certain predictable patterns that we'll have. And one is that we'll do whatever we can to feel better. We'll have a coping mechanism. And God doesn't work in a way where He wants to relieve us of the great thing that He's doing in and through us. But He wants us to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And He wants us to allow the pain to operate in our life to produce things. Pain is very productive. And Job is right in the beginning of this spiritual battle that he's going through in his mind and his soul. Right now, it's not outside of him anymore. Now it's the battle that ensues after the attack that we have to go through to come to a place where we allow patience to have its perfect work. In other words, we allow ourselves to get thrashed, because our thrashing is our growth and development in the Lord. Be comfortable in the pain. I always tell my kids that when they play sports and all that. You know, I just say, hey, enjoy the pain. Just accept it, embrace it. Don't fight it and resist it. Just allow it to do its thing. And I think most of us could attest that pain has taught us things that we could have never known just by reading the Bible. We could have known them intellectually, but Paul talked about the fellowship of the sufferings of Christ. And there is that intimacy, which is the prize of our suffering, the intimacy with Christ. And so verse 20, we'll just finish this off. We'll have communion here in a second. So he says, why is light given to him who is in misery? Basically, like, what's the point of a life that you've given that is going through so much pain? He's not seeing the point. He says, and a life to the bitter of the soul, who long for death, but it does not come. Now that's the point I was trying to draw out here. That when we suffer, let yourself die. Meaning, let the pain kill all the things in your life. That's what's happening. And that's why people commit suicide. People commit suicide because they really love themselves so much. It's not because they hate themselves, because they love themselves. And so when things don't go their way, they want to end it. But that's unfortunate, because if the misery is embraced, God brings forth, that's what's really happening. That we feel that sense of loss and that sense of death, that process, but God uses that. God has that as his tool for glorification. And so we could let ourselves get thrashed, because God in that is giving us real life. That's what he's doing. He's glorifying us with the life of Christ, real life. And real life is that life of God that we experience working in us and through us, that's spiritual, and it kills the flesh, because the flesh is death. In the flesh is death. The Spirit gives life, and that more abundantly. And so we see this incredible process of the Spirit killing, crucifying the things of the flesh, so that there's this wonderful, pure relationship with God. That's what James chapter 1 is all about. Count it all joy, my brethren, when you go through these various trials, knowing. You know that verse? Knowing. There's a knowledge, an understanding that patience, or God working deep things into our life through the suffering, it'll make us complete and lacking in nothing. That's the whole point. It's the process of developing the Christian. So he's longing for death, and search for it more than hidden treasures, who rejoice exceedingly and are glad when they can find the grave. Why not just die to ourselves? That's the whole point. Why is light given to a man whose way is hidden, and whom God has hedged in? Isn't that interesting? You remember God put a hedge of protection around him to prevent stuff from getting in? Now the stuff's in and he can't get out. He's like in a cage match with Satan, and he can't get out. And I think that's good, because we're not supposed to get out. We're supposed to be in there, put on the full armor of God, and we're to stand, and we're to fight, not by might nor by power, but by what? By my Spirit, says the Lord. It's a beautiful thing. Verse 24, for my sighing comes before I eat. I can't eat. I'm so miserable. and my groanings pour out like water, for the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded has actually happened to me. And I am not at ease, it's quite an understatement, nor am I quiet. I have no rest, for trouble comes. And so the desire to die when we go through affliction, if that desire is given to the Lord in full surrender and we allow death to happen, we now begin to understand what it means. If we want to follow Christ, we must take up our cross and follow him. This is a picture of that and a great lead-in to communion here this evening. And so let's pray, and we're going to have the guys pass out the communion elements after we pray. And then if you guys can hold on to that, we'll take it together.